Father in heaven, what a privilege to serve you and to know that you love us so much. In humbleness, we pray for your presence, we pray for your spirit. We pray that you will be the center and the goal and everything we do will be for your glory. We pray that your spirit is going to touch our hearts and fulfill your plans through us. In Jesus' precious name we pray and thank you so much. Amen. Amen. So, I don't know if you are curious about the title. It says Total Commitment. But I'm going to go straight into the subject. And before I do that, I'm going to just say three words about me. My name is Pavel Goya. I think you know that. And I have a fantastic wife. Amen. That I am handicapped without her. I don't even know how to dress myself. I never get it straight colors and anything like that. And two boys, one is 24, one is 21. Wonderful children. We are extremely blessed. I can say it is a great blessing. I travel around quite a lot, giving a prayer seminar, also a revival seminar. Today we will not have time for neither of them. But I'm going to talk about the most simple subject that is the core of all we do. And this is going to be so challenging. And in fact, this is the subject. This is the essence. And if we don't get this one, all we do doesn't make much sense at all. So I'm going to just start asking a few questions. Before you do that, if I go too fast, because I have the bad habit to get excited and move in fast gear, if I go too fast, don't feel bad to raise your hand. You don't hurt my feelings. As soon as I see you doing that, I'm going to slow down so you can get me. Secondly, if you have questions, feel free to ask, because I may not answer them anyway, so just it doesn't bother me. Feel free to ask. Okay, so we love God, don't we? Amen. We do. Yeah. You are here. That tells me that you do love God with all your heart. Amen. We want to serve God, don't we? Yes. Absolutely, no question. We want to be saved, and do you want others to be saved? Yes. We have it in our heart. Well, how many of you, be honest, how many of you feel that you don't have the results you should have? You do? Me too. Now, rewind to the Old Testament. Didn't God split the Red Sea for his people? Yes. I mean, if that happened today, you'd go to the ocean and God would just split the ocean for you. How would you feel about it? Wow. It doesn't grasp our mind, does it? Come on, that cannot happen. How would you feel if God would just multiply your oil and your flour and your whatever? That happened, didn't it? Why doesn't God do it again? Think about New Testament. Peter prayed for Dorca. And she jumped up and walked and worked again. Does it happen every day today? Well, if it did, our churches would be packed. How many times we pray and we don't know about the answer and we are very uncertain and we want to have faith and we struggle and we want to help others know God and many times we ourselves are not sure about what God is going to do. You follow me? But that God says that he discovers his servants, his plans, doesn't it? So what happens here? Did God change? I don't think so. God never does. In fact, he wants to work today as he worked in the past. In fact, the way this work started, when the disciples really got excited about it, and they received the Holy Spirit, and they performed miracles, and they baptized thousands every single day of the week, Tuesday, Monday, every day. This work is going to close with a greater power. Jesus said you'll do greater things. The spirit of prophecy says it's going to be close with fantastic, unimaginable power that we cannot grasp or comprehend. So where are those things? Why don't they happen? We should not be looking for miracles. We should be looking for Christ. somehow Christ should be able to work through us, since we are the body of Christ, his body should be walking around through us and doing what his body did when he was here. You follow me? Christ should do just what he did. For instance, there was no sick when he walked through a village. You remember the quotation? You walk through a village, nobody sick behind. Am I making up stories here? There is a quotation in the spirit of prophecy, and I will make my materials available to you. I am glad to give them everything I have. And the quotation says, to those who offer themselves to God withholding nothing, how much? Nothing. What does it mean? That you give yourself to God, how much? All? How much commitment? Okay, those that offer themselves to God withholding nothing, it says all heavenly power is made available. And then she keeps going on and she says, quote, and you can check, I'm going to give you the quotation. All that the disciples did, every single Christian should do today. How much of what the disciples did? All that they did, every single one should do today. Do we do that? So what is the problem? When I grew up in a very good Seventh-day Adventist church. My parents were just unbelievable good parents. However, I grew up in a very conservative society. And in that conservative society, it was a sin to take the car to the church. I mean it. Come on, you take the car every day. At least in Sabbath, your car can rest. Walk. I mean that. I'm not exaggerating. Every Sabbath, we had to fast. Now the adults could fast the whole day. We kids fasted to noon. And it was kind of painful for me because I want to eat 24/7. I can eat 10 times a day and I'm still hungry. And I never gain a pound. Doesn't matter how much I eat, I'm still hungry. I could eat all the time. I have a very fast metabolism. I burn things while I eat them. So for me to fast half day, I could not even think about Sabbath. All I thought was food. Adults fasted the whole day. In the night, after Sabbath was over, they had a big feast. And then they fell in a coma because they ate too much. And we could do things, but we got to be careful because there were spies. We could not take a bike to church. When I went to Andrews, Sabbath afternoon, we would go to Warren Dunes. How many of you know Warren Dunes? And we were allowed to go in the water up to our knees. That was holy. If the water went a little over, it was a sin, was not appropriate for Sabbath. I'm not going to go in hot issues because we may agree, we may not. But let me ask you, do you know these things in our church? Yes. This you can do, this you cannot do. If you do it, you are a sinner. We are allowed to walk in the Sabbath even up the mountain, though you would perspire to go up the mountain. We are not allowed to run. That would be a sin. There was an apple tree in the front yard of the church. And we could pick up apples from the ground and eat, but not from the tree. That was a sin. It was harvesting. So the man who was cleaning the church, who lived in the front yard of the church in a parsonage house, Abraham was his name, he is still alive, would pick up apples and put them in a nice plate for children so they would not break the Sabbath, picking apples. Now my best friend, Pitsy, is his name. When children would break apples, his father, Abraham, would call him inside and spank him. Didn't you stop the children? I cannot stop them. They don't obey me. And then, bang, bang, bang. And we all were so scared, so we would not touch the apples. And because I felt that I have to do justice, I would go there and knock in the door. Brother Abraham, leave him alone. He didn't break any apples. He would open the door, grab me inside, you, close the door. And then I would see a very strange picture. Pitsy was not spanked. He would be in the top of the couch, smiling. His father had a stick hitting the floor. Didn't I tell you not to do it again? And Pitsy would scream from the couch, please leave me alone. They are not going to break apples again. And then he would look to me. You got to scream too. Now, why do you come here? Oh, please leave me alone. And then he would say, when you go out, don't tell them a word. This way, they don't break the Sabbath. So we would go out, and kids would say, what did he do to you? Oh, I cannot tell you. So, let me go into the subject. We make rules because we don't understand love. And because you don't feel secure. Because when you are loved, and you know that you are loved, and you know that God loves you with a love that is greater than, if you can measure Everest, that's high. And if your sins are as tall as Everest, and you are so small by the mountain, and it's overwhelming, God's love, Everest can be measured, God's love cannot be measured. It's going to be greater than Everest. It goes above you, under you, around you. When I was a kid, my mom had a bath that was stainless steel bath, kind of this shape, and she would put it in the front yard, and we had a tree that was called Queen's tree, I don't know, okay? And it was hot summer, and she would put bubbles in the foam in the bath, and I would get there, feel so good in the water, and every once in a while, I would get under the water, and feel, and then get up again, because I could not hold my breath more than whatever, seconds. And I felt so good surrounded by the water. That's the way we should feel permanently surrounded by God's love. We should swim in God's love. I don't know if you follow me. Yes. When we talk a lot about God's love, but when we are secure and we know that He loves us, then obeying the commandments is not a rule. Amen. It's a delight. Yes. And you don't even try to obey them. You don't even think about them. You just cannot live differently because that's who you are. So when we don't understand love, we don't feel secure. And then we make rules to protect ourselves. And that tells a lot about where we are and about what type of God we have. Christians should be happy people. When you see them sad, it talks about what type of God they have and they know. So going back, is it okay to keep Sabbath? Yes. Absolutely! But commitment and knowing God and serving God is more than good rules. Probably it's about charitable things. Jesus is not going to say, well, you kept the Sabbath, you paid tithe, and you came to church and you did evangelism. Jesus is going to say, I was poor, I was naked, I was thirsty, you remember? So if we keep the rules with all our heart and do a lot of good things and feed the poor and do mission trips, is that okay? It's good, absolutely. Absolutely. But is this why he came for? Is this the essence of his work? He came to help the poor. Well, what about those from other country? I mean, he didn't come to give just a few more days in their life. He came for something greater than that, didn't he? So probably it's not just rules, it's not just doing good things. So what is it about? And Jesus said, I want you to follow me. How do you follow Jesus? He never said it clearly. He just showed us how. But he talked a lot of difficult things that are challenging and are very hard language, like eat my body, drink my blood. That's to digest him, to assimilate him, to become like him. That people see you and see him and there is no difference. You are just like Jesus. I mean that. He said, if you want to save your life, you surely are going to lose it. And if you lose your life for me, you are going to save it. That's big. He said, if you want to get your bread, you are going to lose it, but if you throw your bread, give it away, you finally get it. That doesn't make much sense for us. If you want to be first, you got to be the last one. So, I'm going to give you a few things. I'm going to start answering because we have a lot and I don't know how much you'll cover. Every single time when God calls you to serve and to follow Him, things don't go normal way. Things start going crazy. Amen. When things go right, that's not God. That's you. When things go wrong and everything is bad and everything is upside down, then God is working. We are so comfortable where we are, and every single time God wants to change you and me, we don't want change. When my wife changes furniture, I leave home and I go visiting because I hate changing furniture. They are fine the way they are. I really don't want to change them. We hate change. When God starts changing, we go into a crisis. And we face so many challenges, so many problems that we feel good to go back to the previous stage. And we never want to grow spiritually. Because growth is based on trust, faith. And faith you cannot make sense of. You cannot understand faith. And because we don't understand, we don't follow. Every time we make a decision, should I get this job, should I go there? We need to think and have reasons and logics. And so if I do this, I get there and da, 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 da. And if it makes sense, we do it. Well, when God would ask you to do something, you cannot do that. He's not going to solve your problems. Okay, go to America. I'm going to give you all the money, pay your school, get you a house insurance, and then you can go. He's going to say, go. And then you, how am I going to live there? Go. And just when you get to the Red Sea, not a week in advance or a month in advance, when you get right there at the sea, what am I going to do? Go. And after you step into the sea, He's going to split it. God is not going to solve the problems before you get to the problems. And many times before we get to the problems, we quit. Because you don't know Him enough to trust Him enough to follow Him. Think about Abraham. Do you think it was easy? Leave your country and go. That means that you have such a relationship with God that whatever He says, you do. No questions asked. No logics. Oh, I got to understand. I got to prepare the resources. How am I going to live? How am I going to pay? No questions asked. I don't think Jesus asked any question when the Father said, do it. I really don't. Joseph, God told him, you are going to be over your parents, over your brothers. Did it go the right way? And he got to be the boss. And everybody liked him. He was sold as a slave. He got to prison being innocent. When God works to get you to a higher stage of spiritual growth and commitment, things are going to go crazy. And he got in prison. Don't you think that he prayed, God, I am innocent. You promised to put me here, and here I am. Did God answer his prayer? Not really. How much did he spend in prison? Do you know? I think a lot more. Anyway, let's move on a little. If you would have to stay 3 years in prison, and you pray every day, and you are innocent, how would you feel about God? It's easy to talk, but let's get there, and then we talk again. Hopefully we don't get there, but anyway. So, do you see the point? Job lost everything. Moses had to give up everything. And God promised him something, and then he gets behind the sheep. When God works, things go crazy. And they don't make sense. I have a friend, a relative, that sensed that God is calling him to do something. And he moved, and he changed jobs, and he went there. And things didn't go right, so he got so scared. And before God doing something, he went back to his previous job, and he said, no, I think it was not God, it was my mind. It's like King Saul. He was told to wait 7 days, and he could not wait 7 days. The Bible says, wait upon the Lord, and you don't feel secure before you do it. So, I'm going to go a little into the subject. Jesus says, if anyone wants to be my disciple, he has to hate his husband, and his wife, and his children, and his parents, and even himself. Well, the Bible doesn't say to hate. It says misheo, that means to regard less. That means that you got to love God more than your family, more than yourself, more than your job. Your job should not give you your identity. God should tell who you are, not your job or your education or your house or whatever. So if you are not ready and willing to give up everything, your family, your job, your own life, Jesus says, you are not worthy to be my disciples. That means to follow me, ready to give it up. Are you ready to give it up now? Or you say, how am I going to pay the bills next month? You see, it's a matter of trust. We don't trust somebody that we don't know. So we talk about God quite a lot. I was in Romania. You probably know a little of the story. And I finished construction university, top of the school. Many challenges. They wanted to expel me from the school without any right to ever register in any school again for the rest of my life in Romania for Sabbath issues. And God did extreme miracles. I mean extreme. The president of the country, Ceaușescu, changed the law one day before I was expelled. I was supposed to be expelled that Saturday, and the president changed the law Friday. And he said, from tomorrow, we have no school Saturdays. To save the economy, so nobody would use power and heat and whatever. And that was specifically for me.
Amen.
But anyway, so I finished school, then I finished law school, and then I finished that, and I could not work because of Sabbath issues. So my wife and I, long story, I'm not going to go through the story, started a business making clothing. And we got extremely powerful. The average salary in that time was about $60 a month. A pastor had $64 a month. After paying salaries, after paying taxes, after paying all the materials, all the expenses, we made about $500,000 a year. So it was way above average. I mean, it would be a lot of money here too. And I knew the prime minister of the country, and I knew the mayor of the city, and the chief of the police, and connections, and friends. And they called me to ministry. And they said, would you give up your salary and come for $64 a month? And we did. And I was never sorry, and I am blessed, and I love to serve God. But then we applied for schools. And we applied here and there and there and there, and we got no answer. And as we were looking for a school that I could go to the seminary and get a serious education as a pastor, we wanted to sell our car so we would have money to pay at least the first year of school. So I put my car for sale in the newspaper, on the cable TV, and I went to the auction. Nobody called. When I went to auction, I had a Nissan Datsun. I don't know how many of you, at all times, Datsun, have you ever heard that name ever? Okay. But it was a good car. That was in 80... Don't even remember. Don't ask me. Long ago. No, the car was made in 84. That was in 96 or 97. Anyway, so I went to auction and somebody came and said, hey, how does it work? I said, perfect. And I never had a problem. The car was perfect. So he says, okay, can you start the car? Nothing. I said, it never happened, believe me. Nothing. After he left, come on. Somebody else came. Can you start the car? I hated the car. I got off the car, I started to kick the wheel with my foot. And my wife, honey, calm down. You are a pastor. If somebody would see you, they think that you lost it. Calm down. I hated the car. And she said, maybe God doesn't want us to sell the car. I said, yeah, okay, whatever. I didn't sell the car. Went home. Gave up school. No school called me from Austria, from Germany, from France, from England. I applied to all of them, Newbold, Cologne, you name it. Nobody called me. Forgot about it. When you pray and nothing happens, and you pray and you pray and nothing happens, and then you give it to God and you move on. And when you forget about it, finally God works. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. So I said, God, I want you to go to school, but you know what? This is your problem. Not very happy, but yeah, this is your problem. I'm going to just give it up. When finally I was ready to give up, and gave it up actually, somebody knocks in my door 6 months down the road and says, do you have that Nissan Datsun? I said, yeah. You sell it? No. Well, I want to buy it. I said, how do you know about the car? Well, my wife was starting the fire in the fireplace using newspaper that were old. You figure it out. And he says, I drove from Timișoara. That was 121 kilometers away. That's around 70 more or less miles. I drove here because I want a car. Give me the car. I said, no, not for sale. I was planning to go to school. I don't go to school, so I need a car. So the guy left. After he left, a few hours later, somebody calls me from America and says, hey, Paul, yeah, I'm Lauren. I don't know any Lauren. Yeah, you do? We used to sing in the choir together 14, 13, whatever years ago. So, hey, Lauren! So he says, we met like several years before in Bucharest. And now he calls me from America. And he says, this week I was unable to sleep. You came in my mind every night when I would pray. And I prayed, and God inspired me that you need to come here to the seminary. And I said, nah, not willing. Because we are educated, America is evil. Drugs, shooting on the streets, you lose your children, you lose your faith. Anyway, so I said, nah, not gonna happen. That was the education we received in Romania. Anyway, so I said, no. He said, well, you should pray about it. I said, okay. I prayed, and I said, why in the world did the man come to buy the car? What if this is from God and God really wants us to go to school? And I said, God, if this is from you, I don't know the man, I don't know his name, I don't know his address, I don't know his telephone, email, nothing. Send him back. Well, next morning he knocks on the door. My wife sent me back, you want it 4,200, I'm going to give you 4,500, give me the car. I said, okay, take it. After that, just a few days later, I get a letter from Southern Adventist University. You have been approved for the school, and then go, and this is the paperwork, go to the embassy, get the visa. At the bottom of the letter, there was a Bible promise, Jeremiah 29:11. Hi, Naomi. Good to see you. Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans, and God does have a plan for every human being, not based on who you are or what you can do or what you deserve, based on who he is and his power and his resources and his grace. And because we don't know if we can do it, we don't try to do it. And we pray for things that we can do ourselves. And God is not going to answer because we can do that. We got to pray for things that he alone can do. You follow me? So, going back to the story, I know the plans I have for you. So I said, God, this is challenging. America. We don't know any English. Zero. I mean, bye, hi, thank you. Kind of. No English. Where are you going to live? How are you going to talk? And then God spoke in my mind, lack of faith. You cannot serve me if you don't trust me. It's none of your business. How? Your business, you are the servant, you obey. I am the master, I provide. That's the principle we got to live by if we want to follow Jesus. So, we got in the car. That was not our car because our car was sold. I asked my elder if he would give me a car that was a Dacia. I don't know if you ever heard the word Dacia. It's a junk. Anyway, it has two qualities. It starts and it can break. That's it. Not always. So we got in that Dacia that I borrowed from my elder, and we drove the whole night to Bucharest. When we got there at 4 a.m., there were 956 people ahead of us in the line at the American embassy. 956 people ahead. I don't know how many behind me by the time they opened the embassy. Out of 956, 5 got visa, my family 4 and another one. You would pay $120 just to enter the embassy, regardless if you get a visa or not. Wow. So that would be 2 months' salary. So they would discourage people from even trying to come. People would go to the window and, oh, I want to go and visit my children. No, next one. Please, Lenny, no. And just regardless, they would just say no to everybody. No, 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 no. My wife was at the door praying that we don't get a visa. And she said, listen, I'm not willing to start life all over again. Would you, if somebody asked you to move, leave house? We had an 8-bedroom house. Unbelievable. It was square shape. In the middle of the house was a yard with fountain, and I just, nice. Would you leave everything and go? Don't answer, because it's not easy. Believe me, you get there, not easy. And you are going to get there. And nobody is going to go to heaven before they learn to live by faith alone, based on God alone, nothing that you can do or think. The time is going to be so hard before Jesus comes that those who don't learn to walk with God today, they will not make it. So, they would say, no, 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 no. My wife would say, I'm not willing to leave everything and go and start life all over again. So please, God, please, God. And myself, I said, I'm going to make it so hard that they would reject me. So I get to the window, and he says, why do you go there? School. Why don't you go here to school? I said, well, our school is not accredited. Nah, you are young. I don't know if you come back. I cannot give you visa. I said, thank you. And I left. The guy says, so you are happy? Yep. You paid $120 to get in, and you came to get a visa, didn't you? Yeah. And you are happy that you don't get a visa? Doesn't make sense. Why did you come after all? I said, well, I got to do my duty. I don't do like Jonah. If God sent me, I got to go. But you know, I hope you don't give me visa. And he says, you are nuts. I said, yeah, probably. Because God's wisdom is foolishness for people. Doesn't make sense, doesn't go here. You cannot explain it. Because he sees things that we don't see. Anyway, so I said, really, I really don't want visa. I cannot go against God. So whatever, please don't give me visa, you know. And the guy says, so tell me why you go. I told you before, and I was making fun of him. In Romania, we have a saying, a priest should not repeat twice for an elderly that is deaf. And I said, I'm a priest. And it seems you are deaf. I told you before, I'm not going to answer again. And he said, so you go to school. I said, you see, you know. And he says, how can you prove that you come back? I said, I cannot. Then I cannot let you go. I said, I'm glad you don't let me go. Bye. He said, whoa, 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 wait a second. Can you prove that you come back? I said, no. Can you promise that you come back? No. Why? I said, if God wants me to stay there, I got to stay there. Oh, you go there for money. Nah, you are wrong. I had money here and I gave them up. I don't go there for money. I go there to learn. Well, can you promise that you come back? I said, well, if I promise, would you believe? No. Then why should I promise? So then he says, so you go there to get prepared to be a good pastor, to serve the Lord? Yes. And you cannot promise that you come back? No. And you want me to give you a visa? Yes. I said, no, in fact, really, I don't care. Then he says, what if I give you visa alone so you can serve God? Somebody from the embassy to speak that way, that is impressive. But no visa for your family. I said, no, not going to work. Well, we need to make sure that you come back. We are going to keep your family here. He said, no, not going to go. I'm not going to separate my family. I'm not going to, 4 years? Not to see my children? No way. Either all or nobody. So I turned around and walked. He says, whoa, come back. He called me back and he says, I never do that, but I'm going to give you visa for the whole family. I said, come on, please. We got visa. I got out, told my wife, she started to cry, no, you know. We got on the plane, came here. My friend Lauren, who promised that he's going to pay tuition for me, following week, he had a cardiac arrest. He was dead for 7 minutes. They brought him back, electric shocks. He lost his memory, he lost his business, he lost everything, his boat. So here we are, when God starts working, when he calls you, things are going to go crazy. Here we are, no English, no money, everything we had there, we gave to the poor for free. They took everything. When I told them, hey, I go, They came and they took the refrigerator, the TV, the wash machine, the dryer, the carpet from the floor, the furniture, everything. Neighbors, church people, relatives. Can I have your couch? Take it. Can I have your table? Take it. Within 2 days, our house was empty, just walls. Even clothing, we gave everything. We came just the way we are, no baggage. And we come here, and just shortly after, we have no money, not a place to live, no English, no insurance, no work permit. And Lauren paid school for a month and housing for a month, and no food. So here I am in Collegedale, and I look for food, and I have just a few pennies in my pocket. And I buy a few small, like pretzels, and give it to my children that were small. And my wife and I are so hungry that we are dizzy, we cannot walk because we didn't eat for several days. And we cry and pray. It's hard to imagine. So I get a letter from housing, you got to pay, if not, out. A letter from school, you got to pay tuition. No insurance, no nothing. Didn't God call me to come? Why would he do that? Because when you serve God, you cannot depend on self. When you depend on self, all you do will never be successful. When you serve God, if things happen the way they happened in the past, in order for God to work related to his power, infinite, unbelievable, beyond imagination, you have to rely on God 100%. People say you should think. No, you should not think. You should not think. You should not ask questions. You should not decide anything. You should just say, yes, sir, like a soldier. Whatever he says. He says, go there. You just walk like a robot. That means total faith. And because we are not created robots, we have free will. We like to control, we like to understand, we like to feel secure. And because we don't know God enough, we cannot obey him just like that. To obey him means to know him in order to trust him. You follow me? So I was kind of, why in the world you brought us here and now, hey, where are you? But God was working, and that's the way he works. That's the reason he put Joseph in prison. Imagine if Joseph would said, okay, I give up. Could have God fulfilled the plans for Joseph? And not for him, for others through him. It's not all about me. It's what God can do through you. And God can work through you unlimited. Because God is God. Doesn't matter numbers or power or strength. It's all about what he can do. He doesn't need 1,000 or 1,000,000 people. He needs one ready to obey by faith. So I said, why in the world you brought us here? We don't even have food. I was walking to school, got in the garden of prayer. There is a big trunk there in Collegedale, for those who know. And I got there under the trunk. And I was breaking in tears, crying, God, I don't know what to do. And God was not answering my prayer. So I would go home and pray all night long, and God was not answering my prayer. God, help us and help us and help us. And I got an allergy so bad that my body was full of big things like nodules, and they were burning and itching. And whatever I would do, it would not help. I went to the doctors. They put prednisone in me like crazy. It didn't help. Stress. We worry. Don't we? How am I going to pay the bills? It's like God doesn't care. He doesn't even know that you struggle. You know that? Doesn't he? He knows. Doesn't the Bible say that he knows our very hair? Come on. Do we trust that promise? Doesn't the Bible say that he loves us more than anything? If he gave Jesus, how in the world will he not give us everything? He knows, he loves, he has the power, he has the wisdom. But we don't have the patience to wait upon him and to obey him and to trust him. So we do it. And I focused so much on our misery that I was desperate and stressed and tired and dying. And eventually, praying, after about 2 weeks, I was breaking. Did it ever happen to you that you pray, and the more you pray, the more you struggle? Shouldn't prayer bring relief? You follow me? So instantly, I took steps to Christ. I was inspired to take. And it was there. Every time we focus, I put it in my words, on ourselves, God cannot answer our prayer. We got to focus on Him. I said, what am I doing? So I said, honey, to my wife, let's forget self. Jesus says that we got to die to self. If not, we are not worthy to follow Him or to serve Him. To die to self, it means if I eat or not, really doesn't matter. When I was a kid, children make fun of me that I am an Adventist. And I would come home crying. And my father would take me to the cemetery that was across the street. And he would go to a grave and say, spit him. I said, no, I'm not going to spit a dead guy. Spit him. No, spit him. Okay. Is he upset? No. Now walk on him and hit him. I said, okay. Is he upset? No. Now say some bad words. I said, you stupid. Is he upset? No. Why? He's dead. And my father would say, unless you die, they will do that to you. But when you die, there is nothing they can do against you. You follow? So I told my wife, honey, we cannot serve God because we didn't die to self. And God allows these things in order to use us. And He cannot use you and me before we die to self. That's not easy. It's easier to keep Sabbath and to pay money to the church and to do evangelism and to help the poor. Believe me, a lot easier. In fact, not a big deal. If you want to help, you find ways to help. But to die to self, that doesn't happen. When we argue because we are alive. And we think that we are even right. To die to self, that's big. So, He promises that He's going to take your heart, give you a new heart, give you a new birth, give you a new spirit, give you a new mind, change your mindset, your thinking. He's going to give you victory. He's going to walk with you. He's going to go before you. Israel didn't have to fight the wars. God would go before them. By the time they would get there, the war was already won. They didn't have to fight when they would obey. You follow me? Why do we struggle? Because we don't obey. And I'm not talking about commandments. Right now I'm talking about something bigger. I'm talking about surrender and death and full obedience. You follow me? So, my wife and I took our focus from self and we said, if we die, doesn't matter. We are ready to quit. Okay, let's go back to Romania. It was easy there. Every time God wants you to go to a next level, you go through crisis. So when you go through crisis, God is working on you. And we don't feel comfortable in crisis, so we run back where we came from. So, honey, should we go back? And we said, no. So what we did, we said, you know what? If God works, fine. If He doesn't work, fine. That's none of our business. Our business is to keep going. Servants serve. So I said, don't care. If I don't eat, whenever I'm going to collapse, I walk until I collapse. When I collapse, hey, I collapse. So I kept going to school. I kept learning with allergy. Teachers would say, how can you still come to school? I said, hey, as long as I can, I come, you know. And when I decided that I'm going to move on and stop focusing on my needs and focus on serving God, finally, that Sabbath, Pastor Ed Wright, for those who know him, he's the Georgia Cumberland president right now, he was talking. And guess what? The scripture reading was Jeremiah 29:11. And then he started to speak about Moses. And the sermon started kind of, when God sent Moses to Pharaoh, Moses said, God, I don't know the language. And guess what? He didn't know the language. And God said, who made the tongue? And Moses said, I have nothing except this stick. And God said, if I send you, stop worrying and thinking about resources. You better obey. So we got tears. My wife and I, we took hand in hand and we said, we don't worry for a second. We are going to move on. Because God has a plan and He refuses to tell us today what is going to be tomorrow. He solves today for today and let's get to tomorrow and tomorrow He's going to solve tomorrow. and it's none of our business tomorrow. Our business is to serve, period. Well, I didn't ask anybody for help. I'm going to close the story and go back to the seminar. Our school was paid in full. I don't owe anything to anybody. Housing was paid, everything. We got a green card without even applying for a green card. People paid tens of thousands to lawyers and wait years. We got a letter that we have been selected for a green card, and we got a green card. Finished Andrews. Within 4 days, I was called by the Wisconsin conference, and then later, 9 years later, Kentucky, Tennessee conference. No planning. We said, it's your business, you lead, we follow. Now, I'm going to say this. Easy to talk. When you go through it, not easy. Every day is a challenge. But I'm going to say this. It is more than death to self. It goes more than that. Jesus says, I do nothing from myself. I do whatever the Father tells me to do. And then he goes even more. I don't even speak my words. I speak the words that the Father would put in my mouth. Not because he was a puppet, but he had such a good relationship with the Father that he would not act alone. He would watch what the Father does, what the Father says, and then he would work together with the Father. And then he says, you too, I am the vine, you are the branches. You can do nothing without me. That's the reason we do all the, every day we do nothing. That's the reason we don't succeed and miracles don't happen. God never changed. What he did in the past, he is willing and able and waiting to do today. And he is going to do it again. The last generation is going to walk with God just the way Jesus walked with God. Those who don't live like in heaven today, they are not going to go to heaven tomorrow. We are not going to change when Jesus comes. We got to change now. So basically, Jesus depended on the Father. I have a bunch of quotations. I will make them available to you. Powerful quotations. For instance, it says here, it was in the hours of solitary prayer that Jesus, in his earthly life, received wisdom, power, and the daily plans from the Father. Morning by morning, before light, Jesus would pray and receive grace in order to work for others. Christ is our example in all things. We should, all of us, imitate his example daily. We need communion with God. If Christ, the divine example, needed prayer, how much more we feeble human beings and so on and so forth. Every single servant, those who follow Christ, they should receive the power from heaven as Christ received it daily. Morning by morning, as the heralds of the gospel kneel before the Lord and renew their vows of consecration, he will grant them the presence of his Spirit with reviving, sanctifying power. As they go forth through the day, they have the assurance of the unseen agencies of the Holy Spirit that would enable them to labor in God's power. Anyway, I could give you a bunch of quotations, a bunch of them. Christ depended on God every second. He would not talk before God would say what to say. Imagine if our church members will do that. Imagine if we will not even act before God tells you what to do. If we will not even talk before God tells you what to say. Wow! Can you even imagine that? My grandpa, he died when he was 103. He was among the pioneers in Romania. And he and grandma were together several, he got married with her when he was 23. And he lived until 103. So they had many anniversaries. And they were happy. None of the children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren saw them ever arguing or fighting. And they were just hand in hand. And he was old, honey? And he was already deaf. Honey? Yeah. And he would say, honey, can we walk through the park together? Yeah. And every day they would go for a walk. And then they would get home. And they'd say, grandpa, you never go without her. And he would say, how can I go alone? I said, you just walk. And he would say, I cannot function. I cannot even breathe when I am alone. And then he would say, she is my life. God compares relationship with him with marriage. A connection that you would become one body with Christ. And you cannot function without Christ. He's my life. I cannot breathe. I am dead. I would rather die. A day that we afford to step through that door out without connecting with him is a day that we lose for eternity and you'll never recover. So this is way more than keeping the commandments, what is good, than helping the poor, what is good, than even sacrificing and relationship to the degree that you are totally 100% dependent on God. That God talks to you and you can sense his voice. You know him so well that you know when he talks, you know when he moves, you know what he does. And he reveals to you all his plans. He has no problem to reveal to you. He talks all the time. We never take the time to listen. Even when we pray, we don't listen. We talk and leave. We don't even know how to listen. I had a church member, wonderful lady, committed, loving the Lord. When I talked about commitment, she would say, how do you listen in prayer? And indeed, she talks a lot. I mean, she talks more than I do. We don't even know how to listen. And what time is it? I really don't want to go over time, but let's see. Ooh, 4:24. We have another 5 minutes. That's bad. I'm gonna show you something and we finish today. Because you got the message. This is why Jesus came for. He didn't come here just to heal. He came to show how the Father is like, to give us an example, so we know how to follow him. We know how to know God, how to love God, how to trust God, how to obey God. We reach the level of relationship that we trust him 100%, no questions asked. I'm going to show you this flower. Ladies first, men, quiet. Is this flower dead or alive? It smells beautiful. It looks fantastic. Is it dead or alive? Okay, now men, ladies, quiet. Is dead or alive? Okay. I knew it. Okay. This looks good and smells good. Would you agree? Regardless how many chemicals you put in the water, what is going to happen a week down the road? Why? Look here. This, a week, a month, a year, is going to be still alive. Why? Connected to the roots. This is literally who we are. If we are not connected daily, we may smell good, we may look good, we may do good things, but we are dead people walking around and losing time around and playing church. Just when we are 24/7, every second, not every day, every second of our life, connected and depend on him entirely to the point that he can live in us and through us, and he talks, not you and me, and he acts, not you and me. Just when we are to that degree connected, we are alive. And he can work. And this is what God is calling you and me and the whole church. And then he's going to work again. No question. There are many Bible promises. There are many quotations in the spirit of prophecy. Jesus is coming. And we got to live that way. And we cannot postpone. And that's hard because that requires death. But guess what? Grain, unless it's going to die, cannot live. That's the single way. There is no other way. There is no other way. Good news. If you really love God, you may have a hard time to do it. But if you don't do it, he's going to do it in you. I was driving my a Chrysler Dodge Grand Caravan. Bad transmission. And I was praying, God, help me sell the van. The transmission broke. And I purchased a second-hand transmission, 450 or whatever, I don't remember. Paid another how much labor, replaced it. 3 months down the road, it jerks. Bad transmission again. I hated the car. Put it for sale, nobody called. It's like everybody knew, you know. Lower the price, nobody called. So I prayed, God, help me sell the van. Help me sell the van. Help me sell the van. Nothing happened. And then I said, I got to give it up. I got to live for him. As I have to die daily, the car has to die. You cannot have a car before you give up the car. You cannot have a family before you give up family. You are not worthy of them if you don't give them up and put God first and then the other things. You are unable to use them unless you are willing to put God first. So I was driving my junk between two churches. And I said, Lord, I'm ready to give it up. It was hard. I mean, if you give the van away, what do you drive? That was the car. Good or bad, my car. So I'm ready to give it up. Take it. Whatever you want. If you can use it, it's a junk, you know, I would be glad to give it to you. If you can use it, use it, but it got to be for you. Just don't ask me to give it to somebody. Good to see you again. So I said, it's got to be for you. 10 seconds later, my cell phone rings, and the lady from our church, Pastor, do you still have the van? Yeah. I want to buy it. I said, yeah, it has a bad transmission. If I give you the van, you are never going to love me again or love the church again. I said, no worries. My brother fixed it. He's a mechanic. I said, why do you want the van? And she said, there are people who come to evangelism and they don't have transportation. Children who come to our school and they don't have transportation. I have a small Neon. That's another Dodge. Anyway. And she said, I need a van. I want to use it for God to transport people to church, those that don't have transportation. I said, how much can you pay for it? I said, I don't have the money you asked. She had a lot less. I said, okay, take it. You know what I hate? 8 years down the road. It never broke again. It keeps going. Nothing that we keep, we are going to have, including life. Whatever we fully give in full obedience and full trust, no question asked, full trust, it's what we get. Abraham, after gave up his son, he got his son. That's the way he works. And he's not going to change how he works. We got to change. Let me pray for you. We got to finish. Father in heaven, thank you so much for loving us. We don't deserve it, and we cannot serve you. You don't need us, but you called us. Thank you so much. Thank you for your promises, that they are just unbelievable. Father, we pray that we make a decision today to fully surrender, to totally, no reservations, commit ourselves and our life and to walk with you just like Jesus. Every morning, to wake up early in the morning, as it says in Isaiah, you awaken my ear to listen. Every morning, to wake up and to listen. And to start the day with you and to walk with you and to depend on you. To the point that you can use us and work again and finish the work. Father, help us. Because we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.